like to welcome you all here, and you know, these days I just did it for myself. Turn off your cell phones, maybe? We're going to have a lecture? I know, you know. Remind everyone to turn off their phones before our lecture. I'd like to welcome everyone to this event. Thank you so much for coming. This is the Benjamin Rabinowitz Lecture in Medical Ethics. I'm Michael Rosenthal, the chairperson of the Department of Philosophy, and it's our privilege and delight to have Professor Inmaculada de Melo-Martín tonight here to give our lecture. But before I turn things over to Professor Sarah Gehring for the introduction of our speaker, it's my job to thank people that have made this event possible. First, I want to thank the office staff of the Department of Philosophy, Brad Wessel, Gina Gould, Annette Bernier, who do a lot of work behind the scenes to make this and many other of our events possible. We work together with the program on values and society, and I want to thank Michael Blake, the director of the program, and also Dustin Addington, the program assistant, both of whom have done a lot of work and helped our efforts this evening. I appreciate that. Sarah Gehring, of course, has been involved from the beginning of this and in many other events connected to the Rabinowitz Lecture and endowments, and so thanks to Sarah also for your work on this event. And especially she's on leave, so it's a special, you know, duty that she's taking on here. And I really want to thank maybe Kate Bolden, our outreach coordinator, can stand up for a second, and I know she's very shy. I really want to thank Kate, who's our outreach coordinator, who has just worked tirelessly to make this event happen and many other things that we're trying to do to keep the philosophy department in the public eye and keep our alumni and friends engaged with what we're doing. So thanks very much, Kate. We really appreciate it. Of course, without the generous support of the Rabinowitz and Fisher family, none of this would be possible at all. The lecture is funded by the Benjamin Rabinowitz Chair in Medical Ethics. The purpose of this chair is to support research and teaching in the area of patients' rights, end of life, medical ethics, euthanasia, and delivering progress and compassion in our hospital and clinical settings. The chair is named in honor of Benjamin Rabinowitz, who was a talented journalist, musician, and artist, who unfortunately died at the age of 39 after a courageous battle with cancer. Ben wanted part of his estate to serve and promote compassion in medicine, and his family believes that philosophy is a field that can help us become more compassionate through precise thinking about morally significant and emotionally difficult situations in medical care. The goal of the endowment is to put scholarship in service of families facing difficult, controversial decisions, or dealing with loved ones who are suffering. Over the past years, the Rabinowitz Endowment, and I think many of you here have been engaged with some of the things, the symposia that we've put on over the years, we've helped sponsor symposia on topics such as caring for dementia patients, narratives of illness, relief of pain and suffering, and understanding what hope is in the face of people facing death. And we've always taken the view in all these symposia, and I hope this evening as well, that a broad interdisciplinary dialogue is crucial. So in addition to philosophers, we've invited medical doctors, anthropologists, historians, and psychologists, among others, to join our conversations. The work of our endowment will, of course, continue beyond this evening. And I'm really pleased to announce that in the winter quarter of this coming academic year, 2015, Professor de Melo-Martín will be our Benjamin Rabinowitz Visiting Professor in Medical Ethics. So I hope some of our students at least, and maybe both graduate and undergraduate, will be able to take her class in the winter when it's being offered. That's kind of another way in which we can extend this into the everyday part of the university. So now, without further ado, let me turn things over to Sarah Gehring, who's going to introduce our speaker. Thank you all very much.
Thank you everybody for coming tonight. I'm really happy to have this chance to introduce Inma de Melo-Martín to the group. She's a professor of public health in the Division of Medical Ethics at the Weill Medical College at Cornell University. She has a PhD in philosophy, and she has an MS in molecular biology. And she's been working in areas that bring these two interests together. So she has strong interest in bioethics and medical ethics, and strong interest in philosophy of science, particularly related to biology. So all the spaces in between those two areas as well. She's author of two books. One is Making Babies, Biomedical Technology, Reproductive Ethics, and Public Policy. And another is called Taking Biology Seriously, What Biology Can and Cannot Tell Us About Moral and Public Policy Issues. She's very prolific, so she has a wide range of papers that are out. Some of them they're all on interesting topics. Some of them include dissent and consensus in science, feminist conceptions of objectivity, how values matter when we interpret scientific evidence, papers on what dignity means in bioethics, on dignity and disgust in bioethics, on stem cell research, on genetic interventions, human enhancement, and many more, and of course our topic for tonight, which is sex selection. Now I want to say, to preface this, one of my favorite things about Inma is that she's not afraid to take on loud and mainstream voices that sometimes in bioethics say what I think the rest of us think of as rather shocking things in their articles and arguments. So there's a group of people, and I who have made pretty provocative claims about, on the one hand, an obligation that we all have to morally enhance ourselves. And you might think, a moral philosopher telling us that's a problem? Where's the problem here? But to morally enhance ourselves with biochemical or physiological alterations. So because we're not moral enough right now to deal with the problems we have, we should drug ourselves in certain ways or alter ourselves biochemically so that we'll be better placed, I guess, to handle those sorts of issues. And there's a book called Unfit for the Future, which deals with this problem. And so Inma has written courageously, I think, said, you know, it's a provocative out there thesis, but it's important to combat those things rather than just letting them go in the public eye. And maybe more relevant to tonight's topic, that group has also written papers about what they call the principle of procreative beneficence, which is meant to say we all have a duty, if we want to be parents, to create the best children that we possibly can. And right, if you're just hearing it for the first time, you might think, well, who could be against that duty, right? Wouldn't we all want to create the best children we possibly can? But there are lots of questions about identifying what the best ones are and what makes them the best ones and ranking them, right? Plenty of concerns there, and Inma has, again, written extensively against those arguments and pointing out certain problems with them. So I appreciate her record of scholarship and her ability to stand up to some of the people who have, I think, a lot of public space for these arguments. Now, before we get to the topic, over dinner last night, we were talking about what I have heard has become a new party reason for pregnant people. That is, you have a gender reveal party, where, if you haven't heard of it, you don't actually find out yourself what sex your fetus is, but your physician finds out and then gives you a little note which you take to a baker, and they create perhaps cupcakes that are blue or pink on the inside, so no one can know until you get to the party and bite into the cupcake and find, oh, you know, here it is. But they're called, right, interestingly, gender reveal parties as opposed to revealing something about sex, right? And I don't know that this sort of practice, I don't know what it reveals exactly, except that it's probably not truly about the future gender of the child and more about our society's fascination with sex and the meanings that we presume that sex and gender are going to give us. And I think that's going to be our fun discussion for tonight. So please join me in welcoming Inma.
Thank you to the philosophy department for inviting me. I have had a great time. I arrived yesterday here, and the weather has been fantastic, and I had wonderful food, so I am very excited to come back in the winter. I hear that the weather might not be as nice, but you know, it's not like New York, it's great, so So thank you, everyone. So yes, I'm going to talk about sex selection, gender selection. We'll see part of the concerns that actually talking about sex selection involves. So there are some, you have here some pictures of the blue and the pink that all of you have seen. And interestingly enough, these are actually pictures that come from advertisements from fertility clinics that advertise gender selection. They talk in the advertisement about gender selection. The picture, the very cute girl there, is actually from an article discussing the use of sex selection by Americans. And arguing that contrary to expectations, most people think that when we talk about sex selection that it is a problem because most people would select for boys, you know, that the preference would be boys. And so this article actually is an article that shows that the majority of people who use sex selection in the United States actually do choose girls. And I mean, the article presents this as, isn't this great, you know? What's the criticism about sex selection? We are choosing girls, and that presumably is, you know, it's a good thing. So, again, there are obviously other issues with the pictures that I won't go into in my discussion, but, you know, as you can see, they are all white, which is also relevant. But in this case, again, the selection is about sex rather than issues of race or ethnicity. So there has been a significant amount of debate about sex selection in the bioethics community. And you know, there are a variety of reasons for that debate. So what I want to do here today is present the arguments that have been offered to defend sex selection, what is supposed to be the strongest argument for these, for the selection, for the use of these technologies to do sex selection, and then I'm going to criticize those arguments and you know, say why they are problematic. Okay. So there are. Obviously, this, you know, we haven't started to do sex selection just now. Sex selection obviously has been going on for centuries, and we haven't used, you know, great methods until now. Not that the ones that we have now are great, but you know, normally abortion and infanticide have been the methods that have been used until very recently, and they are still used. For this purpose, you know, to select a child of a particular sex. Now we have technologies that are a little less controversial than abortion or infanticide. So this is one of those technologies, sperm sorting technologies. This technology uses the ability, you know, the fact that sperm that has the X or the Y. Has different DNA content, so they use a dye, a fluorescent dye that is able to attach to the DNA, and because of the different content of the X and the Y, they use a laser that the X chromosome brights, you know, is brighter than the Y one, and so the X, you know, goes to one side, one of the tubes, the Y goes to the other tube, and so they are. In general, they have one of the tubes that would have more X and one that would have more Y, so that they can use in that sperm to increase the chances that you're going to have a boy or a girl. This method is not clinically used. You can actually, the technology is patented, it's Microsoft, and they have some clinical trials that they have done. One of the clinical trials was recruiting for couples who want to do family balancing, and we'll talk a little more about what that means. And the other one was for people who were at risk of passing on some X-linked diseases, so, you know, to avoid that possibility. The evidence seems to indicate that this technology has a, I think it's 93% chance for girls. And I think 82 for boys, so that it's more reliable if you want to have a girl than if you want to have a boy. There is another technology, PGD, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. It is very effective, 100%. So in this case, this is obviously also less controversial than abortion because you use embryos. The embryos are outside of the woman's body, you know, so you use embryos rather than fetuses. What the technology does is used in combination with in vitro fertilization, so you cannot do this by itself, you have to do in vitro fertilization. And the technology actually, you know, uses one of the cells when you have there an embryo, which is normally in the six to eight cell stage, and they biopsy one or two of the cells. They look at the chromosomes and they check whether there is any chromosomal abnormalities with the embryos. That was the reason for the development of this technology. Is the reason why it is normally used. The majority of the times that the technology is used is actually used to eliminate embryos that might have a variety of chromosomal abnormalities that might prevent implantation or cause miscarriages. So again, women who might not be able to get pregnant for a variety of reasons, you know, might use this technology to increase the chances that they are going to be pregnant. So that's one of the reasons why PGD is used. The other reason is to determine whether there is, you know, if someone is at risk of transmitting a genetic disease, they might want to do PGD to avoid the possibility of having children who would have or carry that genetic mutation and suffer from particular diseases. But of course, one of the things that this technology allows, you know, when you are doing the karyotyping, you know, you can see the chromosomes, is that you can determine whether the embryo is going to be, you know, is an XX or an XY. And so the technology is also used as a way to determine the sex of the embryos. Now, again, in many cases, this is done because of medical reasons, you know, because there is the desire to avoid an X-linked disease. So, you know, they might want to know the sex of the embryo in order to avoid certain kinds of embryos. But because the technology is available, we can also use it to simply determine what the sex of the embryo is and implant embryos of the desired sex. So I have here some information because, you know, again, I mentioned before, PGD is always used with in vitro fertilization. Sperm sorting can be used with both in vitro fertilization or artificial insemination. So, obviously, the number of people who use this technology, you know, vitro fertilization is, you know, a small percentage, but increasing. It's a very expensive, it's very time-consuming, you know, it's risky for women. But the use of PGD has been decreasing, you know, as you can see, the 2007 and 2008, the most common use that you have is for the chromosomal abnormalities, and it has decreased, you know, it went down from 2007 to 2008. But as you see, what has increased is actually the use of this technology for sex selection, elective sex. And we use now this technology more often to determine the sex of the embryo than we use it for determining genetic diseases. Which again, most people think that the use of this technology is exclusively for genetic or chromosomal abnormalities. It's not the case. Again, it has there has been an increase of this technology for the use of sex selection, even when it is decreasing for the use of chromosomal abnormalities. So, okay, given this context, and this is in the United States, this data is in the United States, and it's very hard to get this data, actually. So, given this, you know, the use of this technology, what is that the idea, what is that people think and countries think and organizations think about the use of sex selection for social reasons or cultural reasons. So, the United States is an exception in you know, relation to European countries and most countries in the world, actually, when it comes to regulating reproductive technologies. So there are guidelines in the United States. The Association for Reproductive Technologies, you know, has guidelines that clinics has to follow. Most clinics do follow those guidelines, but they are guidelines. Different states might have regulations, but normally, I mean, there is no federal regulation about reproductive technologies, and clinics can choose, you know, what is that they want to do. So some clinics are going to offer PGD for sex selection, some of them are not. In the rest of the world, the countries that regulate reproductive technologies, which again are most of the countries, all prohibit the use of these technologies for sex selection, for non-medical reasons, again. They might allow the use of the technology for medical reasons, but not for non-medical reasons. The professional associations, both nationally and internationally, also oppose this practice. And here you have the statement by the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists. And as you see, the reason that they give, and these are the reasons that, again, most countries have and that most societies and associations have, is that the use of these technologies may ultimately, as you have there, support sexist practices. So the arguments that are normally used by different organizations and, you know, countries is that the fear that if we use these technologies, we might increase sexist practices. There is also a concern that this might change the sex ratio, which in fact we do know that this is happening both in China and in India. This, you know, is a problem. And so, you know, there is a concern that if we use these technologies developing countries, you know, we will increase this, and so we don't want that to happen also in industrialized countries. So again, associations, medical associations have argued that we shouldn't be using these technologies. I mentioned before that the American Association for Reproductive Technologies also in several of their statements have recommended against using this technology for selective sex. And international associations, international documents have also opposed this practice. This is again Article 14 of the European Convention of Human Rights and Biomedicine. And as you can see, the use of techniques of medically assisted procreation shall not be used, shall not be allowed for the purpose of choosing a future child's sex, except in the case of medical reasons. Nonetheless, in spite of all of this opposition by, again, medical associations, countries, international documents, a significant amount of people, the proponents of the use of sex selection techniques argue that there are no reasons, no ethical reasons, to oppose this practice. And that, given that, you know, we shouldn't have regulations that prohibit us from using sex selection. So the framework that proponents use is a framework of rights, procreative rights, or reproductive freedom. And the argument that they are going to use is that reproduction is a basic freedom and that we should not interfere with people's autonomous reproductive choices unless we can show that there is a serious harm from the use of these technologies. So this is the framework that proponents of this right are going to use. And so what I want to do is actually criticize this framework when we talk about sex selection. So one might wonder, again, given all of this opposition to sex selection, why is that these people are defending the use of these technologies to select the sex of embryos or fetuses or sperm. And again, this framework that is used is very appealing, in fact, which is, you know, why obviously people might be persuaded by the arguments that they give. And there are two main reasons why the argument is, or the framework is appealing. One is that it is consistent with what most people think about the importance of reproduction. So most people think that reproductive decisions are very intimate decisions, are very important to our own lives, to what we understand of flourishing, you know, what it means to have a flourishing life, and therefore that the interferences with those choices should be minimal, and only when, again, we can show some serious harms. So, you know, that's one appealing aspect of this framework. The other reason is that this framework is presumed to be value neutral with respect to different conceptions of the good. So the framework presumably allows different people, you know, to use these, you know, the race-based, rights-based framework in ways that are consistent with whatever they think, you know, is a good life, which is also very appealing, you know, for pluralistic democratic society. So these are the two aspects of the argument that seem very appealing. And so these are the two aspects actually that I am going to criticize. And I'm going to argue that there are no good reasons actually to believe that sex selection actually falls under procreative liberty. And I'm going to actually argue that the framework is not value neutral and that it has actually some important normative assumptions that are in no way value neutral. I am not going to here, unless we want to do that during the discussion, but in principle I'm not going to criticize the assumptions. I'm not going to argue that the assumptions are wrong, though I think they are. But that's not, my point is just to show that they are not value neutral, which again, because the framework presents itself as value neutral, at least, well, it is not. So on top of that, the assumptions are problematic, but that's a different issue. Okay, so let's start with the procreative liberty. So the argument, as I was mentioning, is there is the assumption that reproductive freedom is a basic right. And in the United States, you know, we tend to recognize that as indeed a basic right. There is, however, significant disagreements about what exactly it means to have a right to reproduction. So, in most cases, at least a significant amount of people would agree that the right to reproduce involves a right not to reproduce, so not to have children. So contraception and abortion, for example, would be protected under the right not to reproduce. It is more controversial to argue that the right to the liberty rights, I mean reproductive rights, involve a right to reproduce, okay? But some people do so argue, and these proponents of sex selection argue this, that the right to reproduce actually involves a right to procreate. In general, people like John Robertson, for example, one of the main supporters of the right to reproduce, argues that not only does the right to procreate involve the not interference with people's decisions to have children, but actually that that involves not just natural reproduction, but also access to reproductive technologies. So that there should not be limits imposed on people's ability to use these technologies as long as they have money, okay? So it's a negative right. No interference if the technologies are available and if you have the means to pursue, you know, to purchase these technologies. So I'm actually going to use Robertson's again because he's one of the most sophisticated proponents of this right to reproduce understood in this way, and he has forcibly actually defended the right to use these technologies, sex selection among others, but to use PGD for all kinds of selection, you know, selecting traits that are non-medically related, okay? So not just sex, but others. So I'm going to use his arguments. But other people, like Sablescu, Sarah was mentioning before, is another of the ones who argues for the right to reproduce understood in this way, not interference with people's choices, unless we can show harm, and as we will show, they think that there is no harm that follows from the use of these technologies. Okay, so what is that Robertson's argues, what is the argument that he gives to say actually sex selection falls under the scope of procreative liberty? Because, you know, as I was just mentioning, you know, one of the questions that one has is, well, what does it mean to have procreative liberty? And, you know, there are questions about it. But let's agree that actually procreative liberty involves the right to procreate. But why should we think that the right to reproduce also involves the right to have a particular kind of child, which is what sex selection involves? So this is the argument that he gives, you know, he says, well, there is a criterion that we use in order to determine whether a particular activity falls under the scope of procreative liberty. And the reason why it is important to determine whether something falls under procreative liberty is that if it does, then interference is only justified when you show harm. So, you know, it's very important to know whether something falls or not under procreative liberty. So this is the criterion that he offers to determine whether sex selection falls under the scope of procreative liberty. It does if the trait selected, in this case sex, is central or material to a reproductive decision. That means if selecting for this trait is essential to deciding whether having a child of a particular sex is going to make the prospective parents decide whether they are going to reproduce or not. So if my decision to reproduce is grounded on the fact that I want to have a girl, and I am not allowed to use sex selection to determine that I am indeed going to have a girl, then I will not reproduce. Okay? So this is the criterion that he's using to decide whether sex selection is actually falls under the scope of procreative liberty. I am going to argue that there is no good reason to believe that sex selection actually falls under the scope of procreative liberty. So, I'm going to put the criterion here so that we can have it. Robertson's, and again others, recognize that there are a variety of things that have to do with reproduction that might be important for people and might indeed be conditions for people to reproduce that actually do not fall under the scope of procreative liberty. For example, he doesn't think that people have a right to adoption, or he doesn't think that people have a right to home birthing, for example. Or he doesn't think that people have a right to cloning if they are fertile, okay? He, however, recognizes that these three, you know, adoption, home birth, and cloning, might be essential to people's decisions about whether they will reproduce or not. So, but if that is the case, then arguing that sex selection is something that might be essential to people's decisions to reproduce doesn't give us any argument, given that there are other things that are also essential for people, or might be essential for people to reproduce, that actually don't fall under the scope of procreative liberty. So in fact, it doesn't offer an argument for why sex selection is a falls under the scope of procreative liberty. He only argues that it is a factor, a trait, that is essential for people's decisions about whether they want to reproduce or not. But there is no argument there. So that's one problem. Now imagine that actually he has given us an argument, though he hasn't. I'm having here again how he, this is actually a quote from one of his articles. He says, okay, if we want to determine whether a particular trait is a trait that falls under the scope of procreative liberty, this is what we have to ask. We have to ask, does this trait, you know, sex in this case, serve the needs of couples who have strong preferences about the gender of their offspring and who would not reproduce unless they could realize those preferences? So again, it's a question of checking the preferences of the people who are going to be using sex selection. There are many problems with this way of checking, you know, whether a particular activity falls under a right. Not this modus of which is how are we going to determine people's preferences, but let's put that aside. And think about what would it mean to use this criteria, this criterion to determine some other kind of right. So imagine that that we think that the right to education, for example, let's assume that the right to education is understood as a basic right, even if it's a liberty right, you know, we might have to pay for it, but, you know, we think that is a basic right. And we want to determine whether a particular activity related to education actually falls under the scope of education and therefore deserves protection against interference. So imagine that we want to determine whether going to your friend's school is something that falls under the scope of the right to education. And we use this criterion, okay? So the criterion would tell us, is going to your friend's school, the question that we need to ask, is going to your friend's school serve the needs of someone who have strong preference about going to their friend's school and who would not go to school at all unless they are allowed to realize those preferences. Now, I take it that nobody would think that therefore people have a right to go to their friend's school, which again, you know, shows that this criteria to determine what counts or what falls under the right right to reproduce might not be the most reasonable one. Okay, so this means that they have not offered good reasons to believe that procreative liberty actually involves a right to have a particular kind of child. Even if, again, we agree that there is a right, that procreative liberty actually involves a right to have a child, there is no reasons to believe that, or they have not offered any reasons to believe that actually involves a right to have a particular kind of child, which is what sex selection allows us. Okay, so now, so that was the first part of the appealing aspect of the framework. You know, this falls under the procreative liberty. The other part, remember, is the issue of the value neutrality of the framework. The proponents of this of sex selection argue that, you know, the one of the appealing aspects of the framework, as I was mentioning, is that it is value neutral. You can, you know, anybody can use it independently of what their particular beliefs about their good life, their understanding of the good life might be. So again, a good thing, given that we live in pluralistic societies where people have a variety of conceptions of the good life. But one of the issues is that precisely because it is presumed to be neutral with respect to different conceptions of the good, the framework actually precludes an evaluation of the assumptions that ground the defense of sex selection. So what I'm going to do is actually show what some of these assumptions are. And again, though I am not going to evaluate the assumptions, I just want to point them out because they are very important for assessing actually the ethical soundness of sex selection, okay? So the first one is actually related to the conception of sexism. So there are three assumptions that I am going to evaluate, all of them very relevant to sex selection. One of them is, what is the conception of sexism that grounds this defense of sex selection? The other is, what is the conception of good parenting that, you know, grounds the sex selection defense? And the other, what is the conception of medicine? So there might be other assumptions, there are other assumptions, but I'm just going to discuss those three. Again, I think they are the three of them are essential to the understanding or to the assessment, the ethical assessment of sex selection. So the first one is sexism. And the reason why it's very important to evaluate the conception of sexism is because proponents of sex selection actually, as I was mentioning before, understand this as a right, but not as an absolute right. So the second part of the framework is, if there are harms, then there might be reasons to limit the use of sex selection. So, you know, you think, and in fact this is the case, that people who oppose sex selection actually try to show that there are harms. So that, you know, you accept the framework, and you show there are harms, and therefore, you know, we can then use this argument to perhaps limit the use of the technology. But of course, whether there are harms involves certain assumptions about what counts as a harm and who gets harmed. And so these are obviously not neutral, you know, not value neutral. There are substantive normative claims about, you know, harm and who is harmed, what kind of entities can be harmed, and what counts as harm. So that's the reason why evaluating what sexism is so important, because they do recognize that sexism, that if we can show that these practices actually promote sexism, they do recognize that as a harm. So that's the reason this is so important. So though they agree that were we to be able to show that sexism is a result of these technologies would be sufficient to perhaps constrain the use of the technology, their argument is that actually no one has been able to show that harms of sexism follow from the use of this technology. So what understanding of sexism do they have that makes them argue that these technologies actually do not produce those harms? Well, that is, as you have there, the understanding that they have of sexism is the belief that one sex is more valuable or superior to the other. And they say there is no evidence whatsoever that people who use these technologies actually believe that one sex is superior to the other. And that's the reason why that article that I showed at the beginning, you know, the picture of the little girl in pink, was important, because that article actually was exactly what, you know, some of the evidence that they use to show that this is not sexist. They said, you see, they are choosing girls. Therefore, there is no reason to believe that they are, you know, that they believe that girls are inferior to boys. Not only that, they argue, the majority of people who use these technologies for what now has come to be known as balancing reasons. Those of you who have either one boy or a girl, or three boys, three girls, in case you didn't know, your families are unbalanced. So what the technology allows us to do is to balance our families. So apparently, and this is the case, you know, we have evidence that this is the case, the majority of people who use this technology are people who have two boys, they want a girl, two girls, they want a boy. Okay, so they argue, they cannot be sexist because they are having boys and girls. They cannot believe that one boy, I mean, that the boys are superior to the girls. Therefore, you cannot prove that these technologies actually are going to increase sexist practices. Now, there are, however, other ways to understand sexism. And one of those ways that seems at least equally reasonable, perhaps more so, is the belief in the existence of rigid gender roles. If we believe that this is what sexism involves, or at least this is a significant part of what sexism involves, then it is a little harder to determine, to say that there is no harm that comes from the use of this technology. Because as we were mentioning before, though what the technology does is to select for sex, chromosomal sex, in fact, what the clinics advertise and what the parents want and what the proponents of this technology actually argue that is legitimate is the selection of gender, not the selection of sex. Nobody wants to have a boy or a girl because of physiological characteristics. They want to have boys and girls because of gender role characteristics, because of normative attitudes that we have, beliefs that we have about what is supposed to have a boy or a girl. And in fact, the argument that proponents give is that that is precisely the reason why it is legitimate for people to choose, is because there are different experiences associated with raising a boy or a girl, and that is precisely what families want, those different experiences. But again, those different experiences are related to issues of gender, you know, or beliefs about gender and gender norms, not with sex. If this is the understanding of sexism that we have, again, it is harder to argue that that there are no harms that derive from the use of these technologies, because we have lots of evidence, in fact, that rigid gender roles are actually not good for human beings, particularly for women, that there are all kinds of disadvantages that result precisely from the beliefs in these gender roles that are affecting women still today, unfortunately. So again, I am not arguing that the conception that they have of sexism is wrong. I'm simply pointing out that there are other conceptions, and if we do have other conceptions, it's easier to show that harms actually result from the use of these technologies. So the other assumption that I was mentioning is the issue of parenting. You know, what conception of parenting actually grounds the defense of sex selection. And one of the things that proponents argue is that sex is actually not a characteristic that is either good or bad. So they agree that sex is morally neutral. It is irrelevant whether you have a boy or a girl. It's just a question of having a preference for raising a boy or a girl. So, but if that is the case, then they do have a normative conception of parenting, you know, that is presupposed by their arguments. Those are two of the characteristics of that conception, that making decisions that are merely expression of parental preference instead of a response to a future child's need is appropriate, you know, that it is consistent with good parenting, that parents can make choices that have nothing to do with the well-being of the child, that are only related to the preferences of the parents. And it is also assumed by this conception that having control and exercising control over these moral neutral characteristics that are, again, the result of preferences, is also appropriate to good parenting. Again, whether one agrees or not with that understanding of good parenting, I'm not going to argue about it, but I'm going to say that there are others, other conceptions of good parenting, one that is actually quite common, one that actually we do have some empirical evidence for. There has been some studies about what people think that good parenting constitutes, what does it mean to be a good parent. And this has been interesting because there have been some studies done with people who are in clinics, infertility clinics, actually who are going to use PGD for sex selection. And so there was a study done in Texas to ask these people what did they think about the use of sex selection. And even people who are about to use the technology or who had used the technology are reluctant, feel uncomfortable, and the reason they give is inconsistent with good parenting, which is fascinating. But so this is again to show that there is at least a very important understanding, normative understanding of good parenting that involves the belief that parents ought to love whatever child comes along, and that it is inappropriate to choose trivial characteristics of your future children simply because you prefer those characteristics. That there is something inconsistent about those choices with good parenting. Again, I'm not going to argue whether one of these conceptions is better or worse, but given that the framework is one that argues that it's morally neutral, I just want to show that it is far from morally neutral. The other, the last one is the understanding of medicine. So again, these technologies are happen under the umbrella of medicine. So there is certain understanding that, certain conception of the goals of medicine that also grounds this defense of sex selection. So in the case of the proponents, the normative conception that actually grounds these, the use of sex selection practices is that it is appropriate for doctors to simply pay heed to expression of mere preference from their patients. Now, I'm sure that all of you are thinking, well, don't doctors already do that? Well, yes, they might. But still, that is a particular understanding of medicine. But not only that, perhaps I think more clearly problematic is the fact that they seem to think that it is okay for doctors to actually sanction and to even promote, you know, under the authority of medicine and science, incorrect beliefs about the relationships between sex and gender. Remember that, as I was mentioning before, the only thing that the technology can guarantee is that you are going to have a chromosomal sex. But we have lots of evidence that chromosomal sex is in no way determinative of gender. It's not even determinative of other sexual characteristics. So that the only thing that the clinic can guarantee is that you're going to have an XX or an XY human being. But you cannot guarantee that the XX is going to behave like a typical girl, or that the XY is going to behave as a typical boy. However, what they do advertise is gender selection. We will give you the pink girl or the blue boy. So this seems false, but and again, the proponents of this of sex selection actually are okay with that, you know, not making the distinction between the sex and gender. So they seem to believe it's okay for doctors to lie to their patients and to, you know, allow them to believe that what they are getting is something that they can actually not guarantee. There are, as you can imagine, other conceptions of the goals of medicine that might not sanction doctors lying to their patients or promoting false beliefs about what it is that they can offer. And that have other understandings of medicine that do not involve to simply do whatever you know, that attend to mere preferences from their from patients, but you know, to attend to issues of disease and disability, suffering, prevention of premature death. Again, I'm not going to argue, in case I need to, that one of these conceptions might be better than the other. And you know, it's controversial to talk about the goals of medicine. You know, different people might understand those things differently. But again, the only thing that I need to show to call into question the framework is that it is not morally neutral. So, to conclude, so in the case of sex selection for social reasons, for non-medical reasons, I think using this framework, as appealing as it might be, is problematic. One of the reasons is because there are no justifications that have been offered to argue that sex selection actually falls under procreative liberty. And the other one is because though it is presented under the guise of value neutrality, in fact presupposes substantive normative conceptions about medicine, sex, asthma, and what it means to be a good parent. Thank you.
Questions. If you can repeat them when they are asked, just so that it'll be clear if we have this recorded. And I also do want to remind people, I didn't say it before, but we have a wonderful reception across the hall when we're done. So we'll have time for questions here. If we don't get to your question, bring it across the hall, and there are lots of wonderful things that you can drink there. Do we have questions to start us off?
Hi. It's a wonderful talk. Thank you for coming. I do worry about the extent to which sex selection is being linked to the subject of sexism, in part because it sounds to me that you're creating a connotation of things as sexism that might in fact simply be a response to sexism. Mm-hmm. So you might say, I want the experience of raising a girl, in part because I think I can guide her through a sexist society, which will impose gender norms upon her, and it's simply going to be a different experience. Now, I think one thing that I want to draw from this is that something can be an institution that works inside a sexist world without itself being condemnable as sexist. I mean, marriage and various other social institutions have a history of ingrained sexism. It doesn't mean we stop having the freedom to marry, it means that we work against the sexist bits of it. Now related to this, I think there's a subtly different worry I had about the conception of medicine as it ought to respond to health and to good things. And it strikes me that this means that sex selection is now essentially in the same category as breast augmentation. And breast augmentation is, ethically speaking, a little squicky, but it's not illegal. And the doctors who do it are not evil. They're just kind of wastes. That sounds like so I'm wondering what it is about sex selection that we shouldn't just lump it in with the category of, yeah, it's a little squicky, but if the relationship to one's body allows you to be less than perfect on gender relations, why aren't we allowed to move forward?
So the first one first. I agree that indeed, you know, we have a sexist society, and of course, you know, the technologies that we develop are not value neutral, and yes, they, you know, sometimes are going to, are likely to, at least not challenge those sexist beliefs, but you know, they might not be promoting it in a particular way. And again, I mean, this might be an empirical question. You know, are we promoting sexist beliefs by using these technologies? And it is not clear to me that we are not. Again, if we think that the conception of sexism that we have is the belief in rigid gender norms, and we do have evidence that that belief is problematic, and we do, then to the extent that the reason why parents want these technologies is because they have particular ideas about what it means to be a boy or a girl, then it seems to me that, at least in principle, you know, this might promote sexist beliefs and practices. The other aspect, and again, that's, you know, I was mentioning, I'm sure that many of you, when I was talking about using medicine in ways that attends to mere preferences, you know, plastic surgeries, at least certain kinds of plastic surgery obviously comes to mind. And yes, we do have that, you know, obviously many people, many doctors do that. And we might think, well, there's something fishy about it, but you know, it's not like everyone has a problem with it. I agree. I am not completely, that argument is not particularly compelling to me, because my argument might be, well, perhaps we should have the same attitude towards plastic surgery. So again, my point was to show perhaps that's the case, and my point is only to point out it's not morally neutral. There is a particular conception of medicine that is there, and you know, whether we agree or not with that conception of medicine is obviously a different issue. Yeah.
Thanks so much for the talk. So I wanted to ask a little more about the conception of good parenting that you mentioned as the alternative, because that sounds right to me. But then I start trying to think of counterexamples. And so here's a couple other, these are preferences that I really have, and I hope these don't make me a bad
parent.
So one preference I have is, other things being equal, not to have a child born, say, in the middle of February. It can be really inconvenient. And it's not a strong preference, and I'll still, if I have a child born in the middle of February, I'll still love them. I'd also prefer to have a child who's a good sleeper. I hear that's a real plus. And if I have a bad sleeping child, I'll love them, of course. But
Most of the time,
right. I can waver. So those seem like okay preferences for me to have. Hopefully don't mean that I'm on the negative list as a parent.
Yeah.
So, and those seem different to me than the sex selection, but
yeah.
Is there some principled reason why?
Well, one of the things that I did say a few times is I don't want to defend one particular conception of parenting over another. Perhaps one of the things that why it might give us some illusion that there is something different is that, well, these technologies are quite expensive. Lots of resources that could be used, you know, for other purposes. And, you know, there is nothing you can do about, you might prefer to have a child who sleeps well, but, you know, right now there is not much that you can do other than wish that be the case. And it's not particularly high tech to determine when your child might be born, if you can do that, you know. So there has, you know, something might have to do with there is this issue about the control and the exercising of control of particular characteristics that seems, you know, what makes us think there's something different about those preferences than the one. Because again, one of the arguments that is given is, you know, what's the big deal? I mean, if you want a girl and then you get a boy, you're gonna love the boy anyway, or the other way around. Well, perhaps. But I mean, someone who goes through so much trouble and spends so much money, you know, to because they want to have a boy, at least it's going to be a little, you know, are they really going to love the boy or the girl, whatever, in the same way? And it doesn't seem to me crazy, you know, to believe that, well, if you have that much desire for having a boy or a girl, this is going to mean something for, you know, how you are going to treat that boy or that girl. So.
Right. Thanks.
Yeah. Speaking from like a medical ethics point of view, I mean, you're having elective surgery for like breast augmentation.
Yeah.
That would be personal. That would be for you. But this is making a decision for another life. So
yeah.
Have you ever found into issues with future ethics for that life?
Well, so that's an interesting question. Okay, so some people have argued that the reason why sex selection might be problematic is because it might harm the children. You know, one of the reasons in the harming is, you know, if we do believe that rigid gender norms are a problem, and you know, believe that girls ought to behave in particular ways and boys behave in particular ways, then, you know, this is a harm for the children. Or again, the possibility that you want a boy and what you get is a girl, and then you know, might not treat the girl or the boy in the particular, you know, in appropriate ways. There is, however, a problem with those arguments that, you know, anyone who presents arguments about harming, you know, children who are conceived always is going to present this objection, and that's the reason I didn't bring it up. And you know, whether someone believes that this is an objection or not depends on a variety of assumptions. But the argument is, it is not feasible to say, or appropriate to say, that you are harming the child, because the child would not have been born had you not used this technology. So unless the child is going to have a terrible life, you know, it would be strange for the child to say, by the way, you've harmed me by making me a boy or making me a girl. Because the alternative is, well, you wouldn't be there. So that's the reason it is hard to make arguments about harming the children. But again, many people would have used that argument, that yes, there is a harm to children who are, you know, who again, because either the gender roles that we impose on them, or because of the possibility of we don't love them as we would. Yeah.
Thank you for your talk. And one question, one point that struck me as weird in the view that you were criticizing was the idea that, well, the argument is that this is, it's legitimate to engage in sex selection if the preference is so strong that people would not have a child otherwise. And I'm just thinking about people in the world and whether we all walk around with these clear, strong preferences very clearly worked out. It just seems like such a strange understanding of human motivation around childbearing.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, you know, there can't be very many people to whom it would actually apply in the world.
Yeah, yeah, and again, you know, there are, I mean, a variety of problems with that criterion. One of them is the issue of how are you determining the preferences, you know, one of the possibilities, I mean, this is an epistemic issue, you know, how do we know that your preference is so strong that you would not reproduce? I mean, one choice is you wait until the end of the reproductive life of the people, and if they hadn't reproduced, but that's not going to be particularly helpful to them, obviously. So, I mean, one thing is that it's very difficult to determine preferences. But the other thing is, you know, most people don't have those very strong preferences. But I think, again, the in his case is, I mean, if someone is going through all of this trouble to be able to determine the sex of the children, clearly they have strong preferences. You know, because these technologies are not cheap. And again, in the case of PGD, using it with IVF, this involves serious risks to women. And again, in very expensive technologies. So clearly their preferences are strong. And again, in the case of families, you know, the balancing thing, apparently people do think that there is something that they are missing and that is very important to their lives. If they have boys, you know, to have a girl, or if they have girls, you know, to have a boy. So, but yeah.
No, thank you, great talk.
Thank you.
So I'm just thinking about some examples where those preferences might actually be strong.
Okay.
And might actually be somewhat legitimate. I mean,
uh-huh.
For consideration. So off the top of my
yeah.
head. A woman who was sexually assaulted repeatedly throughout her lifetime, can't trust men, wants a child, and is afraid to have a son.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I've heard cases of incest
mm-hmm.
like this, where they worry about whether they can be a good parent to a son
mm-hmm.
because they have fundamental trust issues
yeah.
with men because of their experience. That's
mm-hmm.
case number one. Case number two is caregiving in the future. I will love my children together, but I think I will be better served when I'm old if I have daughters
mm-hmm.
than if
yeah.
I have sons.
Mm-hmm.
That's a gender bias.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
There's some evidence for it.
Yes, a little bit of it.
You know, and hopefully that's a societal problem that
yes.
if we change what we expect of men,
mm-hmm.
or we've started, as we have with fathers, they can step up if
mm-hmm.
you ask them to do so, right? Or you find out that in families where there are only boys, they actually step up.
Yeah.
So, but I may be like, my experience, not so much.
Yeah.
I always
mm-hmm.
get ditched by the
yeah.
guys. So
yeah.
I want a girl, and I can rely on her.
Yes.
Because I am one.
Mm-hmm.
Third, my husband doesn't have children precisely for this reason. mm-hmm. and he surrounds himself with females. Mm-hmm. And he would do better if he was going to have a child than
yeah,
a girl.
To have a girl. Yeah.
Because he feels like he would be a better parent.
Yeah. Yeah.
So those don't seem crazy to
me. Yeah, okay. So again, you know, my argument was not that anybody who wants to use these technologies has a sexist belief. What I was trying to show is that it might not be the case that everybody who uses these technologies doesn't have a sexist belief. And again, if this is a question of can we show harms that derive from this technology or from the use of this technology, then I don't need to show that everybody is sexist. I need to only show that, well, there is a reasonable conception of sexism that is consistent with the belief that the use of these technologies is actually going to increase sexist practices. So I don't want to argue that anybody who uses these technologies has a sexist motivation. Again, I don't think I need to. And yes, I believe that there might be, you know, what we might consider legitimate reasons for preferring a boy or a girl or the other way around. The other thing about the, you know, wanting girls because it's more likely to help me when I'm old, I am, this is not just for sex selection, but I am concerned with the use of medicine to solve social problems. So you know, if we can solve the social problem in other ways, you know, it might be a better strategy. It might be more difficult, you know, because we like technological fixes. But it might be, obviously, a better way to go.
But what is birth control at all except a medical solution to a social problem?
How come?
Well, the idea is you giving people the power to choose when to have their children.
Yeah, but why is that just a social problem?
That's not curing a disease.
No, but having children is a very, you know, has significant effects on people's lives, particularly on women's lives.
Uh-huh. And,
you know, not just the 9 months of pregnancy.
But the sex of one's child also has significant effects on people's lives.
Well, they might, but the reason why that is the case might be because we have sexist societies. There is nothing about having a child that independently, even if we have perfect societies with the best policies in the world, still having a child is going to be, you know, a significant investment. And, you know, choosing to have one child or 20, you know, three, obviously also have significant implications for people's lives. So again, I don't need to argue that you know, my claim is that perhaps there are never a good way to use social, medical solutions, or in this case, biomedical solutions, you know, for problems that might also be social problems. And most of the problems that, you know, either medical problems are in part social problems also. Only that, again, there might be some problems that, you know, might be better solved without using medicine if we can do so. Even again, if I agree that there is something about, you know, that is social in the case of having children, it might be that the only way that to solve that problem is actually by medical means, or at least to solve it effectively. You know, we always could stop having sex, but, you know, that would not be that fun, so.
Okay, in spirit, in the echoing some of the other questions here, I'm a bit worried about the focus of the paper is really good, really clear, and seems to have the right sort of results for the cases you're considering. But in the background is this regulatory framework, which seems to me like a pretty blunt instrument. It seems an absolute prohibition on sex selection for any kind of social reason, any kind of non-medical reason, and I'm sure that you have stuff to say about that distinction in itself. And it seems to me that such a broad prohibition does require really serious justification. That's what the appeal of the
Yes, of the framework.
The first framework.
Mm-hmm.
is. I guess I'm not sure that you're given that.
Yeah, but.
So would you like, so in a way I want to invite you to,
yes,
to say whether you really want to defend that strong prohibition and why.
Yeah, so I mean, if one of the things I want to say, I actually did not talk about prohibition. My point was to simply argue, their position is there are no reasons to have any regulations against this technology because of this. What I wanted to show is actually, well, that might not be the case, and we might actually have reasons to regulate this technology. Now, of course, now comes the second part. How do we regulate this technology? What is reasonable to do, you know, given many of the things that we have? And that's a more difficult question, obviously. But I think, again, what I find problematic about the framework is that it's very appealing, and that it seems that if they are correct, then we have to have very strong reasons to interfere with people's choices of, to use sex selection. But what I wanted to show is, well, perhaps this is not at all a right, doesn't fall at all under procreative liberty, and therefore, you know, we may not have that the strong call against interference is not that strong. And two, it is not morally neutral. So it is, again, the defense of these presupposed particular conservative assumptions. So again, that was the only thing I wanted to show. It is true that, of course, it seems that the next step is, well, if this is the case, then how are you going to regulate this technology? And I recognize that is a more difficult decision. But I want to call attention to the fact that, you know, Europeans seem to be perfectly okay that, I mean, Europe is falling apart for other reasons, but it doesn't seem to be because they are prohibiting sex selection. So I'm not completely sure that, I mean, again, you know, European context is completely different than the context in the United States about these issues, but I guess I don't have, you know, an immediate strong reaction against, let's make this use of this technology illegal, unless you have good reasons, and then what counts as a good reason is going to have to be determined. But I also recognize, perhaps, we just want to say, it is not the case that this technology is, that using this is a procreative right. And it is not the case that it's morally neutral, but the kinds of interference that we would have to have are so strong that we'd rather not. It doesn't seem that this is going to create such a big problem. After all, when the sperm sorting comes around, we might have more of a problem. But right now, again, who uses IVF and PGD? A very small percentage of people. How important is going to be this in this scheme of sexism? Well, not very much. So that it might be that, you know, it's not worth our time to interfere with the use of this technology. It might be that we conclude that. But again, the point is that if we do, it's not because we think that it's a right to use these technologies. I'm not sure whether you are satisfied with that response. But again, I'm not completely sure that it makes no sense to prohibit the use of this technology. I am also sympathetic to perhaps, you know, the use of this technology, at least at this point, doesn't seem to, you know, be so problematic, so we don't want to do anything about it. But we want to call attention to the fact that nobody has a right to use these technologies.
I have to think about it. If it was demonstrated that actually people have fewer children if they have the right to use this technology.
Yeah. Well, this actually has been an argument that has been offered for why it might be a good idea too, because, you know, the one response that I've gotten is, well, I mean, imagine the alternative. Someone has three boys and they want to go for the girl, so they go for the next one and it's a boy, and they go for the next one and it's a boy. So certainly that's not a good idea. So why not just use this technology that is effective and... So there are many things to say about that. This also involves the issue of, does the right to have children, you know, even understood as a right to procreate, involve the right to have as many children as you want? I think that is also an open question. But I am not sure that that would be one of the considerations that is relevant for this, for the issue of how we regulate the technology. If indeed we can show that regulating this technology means, you know, we get more of a population, well, it might be that in that case it might be better for all of us not to regulate the technology. But at this point, I mean, we don't have evidence that, you know, people are having fewer children simply because they can use this technology. As I was mentioning, again, the people who use this technology are people who already have a few children. So
maybe this will be the last question, and then we can go into the questions.
It strikes me that the expense of the technology is not an accidental part of the story. In fact, this came out more in your question and answer, but it seems that one version of your argument is that anyone who wants to spend tens of thousands of dollars to have a girl has weird ideas about girls.
No.
Well, but I actually think that's possibly a good reconstruction, because imagine an alternative. Imagine that we discover the impossible. If you conceive while holding a pineapple above your head at midnight, you'll have a girl.
Yes.
Right? Now, does it become wrongful for us to conceive with the pineapple over our head? I don't think it is as wrongful.
Yeah.
In part because at that point, it seems much more like a matter of bodily integrity and the use of your body.
Yes.
You might be complicit in a sexist culture, but you haven't spent tens of thousands of dollars to ensure its perpetuation.
Yeah.
Now, that's at least my version of your argument that I quite like, but it's also on a collision course with itself, because if the technology gets better and better, that starts to look more like the pineapple.
Yes.
Is the force of your argument going to dissipate as well?
Yeah, so I want to say, no, I don't think that at least I was not intending to do so, to argue that the reason why this is problematic is because it's expensive. I mean, eventually the sperm sorting is probably going to be quite cheap. And I would have the same arguments if the thing was to put a pineapple in your head. In fact, this has been a method that people have tried to use, you know, not the pineapple, but exactly, you have a 50% chance. So no, I would have the same objections in the sense of, well, if the reason for this is that you think that there are particular gender norms, then this is a problem. And, you know, we'd rather not do that, and we'd rather try for people not to impose these gender norms, particularly because they are bad for women. I mean, they are bad for everybody, but particularly for women. So I would be inclined to say this is a problem no matter what technology we use, but then there is the issue of, but what does it mean to interfere with people's choices in that case? So in the case of this technology, it's relatively easy to interfere with them. You know, you just make that technology unavailable for this purpose. In the case of the pineapple, it's a little harder. So, you know, we might not want to go that far for this purpose.
Tariffs on pineapple.